So this is a short introduction about the HIFI instruments. If you are very familiar with hetero line detection, that is not going to be very helpful, but I think there are some tricks in this instrument, especially compared to the previous ones you've heard about, PAX and SPIRE. So I'm going to try to explain what are the peculiarities of this instrument. So a short word about how we did work and what actually are the specific science cases for which you would be most interested to use that instrument. And I'd say a word about the way we calibrated the data, and because again, HIFI is using a slightly different scheme from what the other instruments were doing. And because HIFI was a single pixel on the sky, it's very, very relevant to be aware of what its beam on the sky was. So what was HIFI? In essence, HIFI was an instrument using what we call the heterodyne detection technique. So why do you need an heterodyne detection? It's basically the same concept as was used more than 100 years ago on old radios, and this is also something you have in your own mobile phones, for example. The concept of the heterodyne detection is that you are interested in detecting a signal which is at a certain frequency, and typically for HIFI, pretty high frequency. But you cannot amplify this information with your electronics without basically losing the signal in the amplification process, because your processor and components are too noisy. So the concept of the heterodyne detection is that you will migrate the frequency of your signal onto a frequency domain which is much lower, and that frequency domain much lower is called the intermediate frequency. I will show that in a little scheme in the next slide. And when you have moved your information at that lowest frequency, then you have all the necessary electronic components to amplify the signal without losing and basically overflowing the signal, the astronomical signal, into loads of electronical noise and so on. So that concept of bringing the information from a very high frequency down to a lower frequency is called the down conversion. And as I said, you will have that in many, many domestic devices that we are using nowadays. But if you look at it from a schematic perspective, so you have a signal. So here I show, for example, the signal in a certain part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And that signal, when you mix it to another signal, which we call the local oscillator is just an engineering device which is inside the instrument and helps to convert the sky signal to the low frequency. When you mix those two signals, you basically create a bit like when you play the guitar. If you play two strings at the same time and they are mistuned by half a tone, you will create a beat, which is the difference between those two notes. When here we do the same, the difference between the two frequencies, which would be the two notes here, is exactly the frequency at which you will get your signal in what we call this intermediate frequency, which is much lower because this is just the difference between those two very high frequencies. Now, there is a peculiarity in the HIFI instrument is that the device we use to do that down conversion is nonlinear, and that means you are simultaneously sensitive to two portions of the electromagnetic spectrum. One which we call the upper sideband, so it's a portion of the spectrum which lies above the local oscillator frequency, and one which is called the lower sideband, which lies symmetrically on the other side of that reference frequency. When you end up with your signal in the intermediate frequency, those two information are merged. So that will be one fundamental aspect in the HIFI data is you have this degeneracy, if you like, of the frequency scale, because you end up with a spectrum that has two information merged into one single spectrum. And that is all the interest of those data, to try to disentangle what frequency those features or those channels in frequency should be assigned to one or the other of the sidebands. So HIFI system in that sense is called a double sideband system. It is sensitive to the two sidebands at the same time. In many ground-based telescopes, you have an equivalent system, but they are called single sideband because they use special techniques to separate the sidebands, but that is not something that was possible to fly on HIFI at the time. So with this in mind, the HIFI instrument was built following different detectors that would all cover contiguous spectral ranges in order to cover basically complete total range between typically 500 gigahertz up to 1900 gigahertz, which in wavelength is about 160 up to 620. There is a slight gap between 1270 and 1400. There was no detector at that in that range. That's basically due to technology limitation. So we have seven bands in the end, covering different portion of the spectrum. The first five bands are what we call the SIS mixer bands. It's just they use a special technique of the detectors, and they have an instantaneous bandwidth of 4 gigahertz. That again, I'll put that in perspective with the other spectrometers you've heard about in the past days, because that's a fairly small instantaneous bandwidth, but that's because it's very high resolution in spectral domain. On the upper end of the band, we have the band 6 and 7, which are a bit peculiar because they're using different detectors called the hot electron bolometers, and those also have their peculiarities in terms of calibration. And in the next presentation, you'll hear about the artifacts that you might still be confronted with on those particular data, because they need more challenging data processing and calibration schemes. The instantaneous bandwidth in those two bands was slightly lower, 2.4 gigahertz. And I recall here the beam, although I'll say a word about that a bit later. So HIFI is diffraction limited, and that means that with a 3.5 meter telescope, you have a beam size basically ranging from 44 down to 11 arc seconds. We sampled the spectrum onto two spectrometers. There was a wideband spectrometer that would always provide the full coverage of the instantaneous bandwidth, so either 2.4 or 4 gigahertz, but its spectral resolution was fixed, and it was about 1 megahertz. Then you had the possibility to use in parallel the high-resolution spectrometer, but then the resolution could go down as 0.1 megahertz, which is typically 20 meter per second at the very highest frequency. So this is to tell you the kind of data you will find in the archive, and you will always almost find the data simultaneously taken by the two spectrometers, but whenever the HRS was selected, it was to zoom on a particular spectral feature usually. Then those data were taken in three different modes. The one that was used mostly is the single point observation. And in each mode, there was different flavors in the way to take what we call the reference data, because HIFI is a differential instrument. You cannot measure in total power like, for example, Spire did, or the photometers on the other cameras. You need to calibrate the background emission. That's mandatory. And therefore, there was always a necessity to observe a reference position, or what we call the off. And there were different ways to do that, basically adapted to the source morphology, because you could look for a reference position very far from your target, or if your target was pretty point-like, you could afford having it very close by. So all these different flavors were basically unfolded into different sub-modes within each main AOT, which is the Astronomic Observing Template. On the mapping side, there was equivalent kinds of observing flavors. And the one that was most used in that sense is when you have an extended source, you want to use this so-called on-the-fly mode, which is just, it's the most similar to what the other cameras were doing, which is the sweeping on the sky and by scanning lines over different coverage, you will build your map pixel per pixel. And finally, the mode that was very popular given the very large frequency coverage of HIFI was the spectral scan, where you will build basically the equivalent of an SCD, if you like, with a very, very high spectral resolution. But you had to do that piece by piece because, as I said, you had seven independent detectors and they could not be operated simultaneously, unfortunately. So you had to do it piece by piece. If you put the HIFI spectrometer in perspective with the other spectrometer on Herschel, you see that there was a very, very large overlap with the Spire spectrometer. and a smaller overlap at the lower frequency range, so higher wavelength range of the PAX instrument. That is something very relevant for cross-calibration. If you ever want to use data that have been observed by different instruments at the same time, it can be very useful. Now, the main difference is that PAX and Teyssier would provide those indicated ranges in a single coverage. So for Teyssier, in one shot, you get the whole blue coverage here between 200 and 700 microns. For HIFI, you had to do it piece by piece, and those pieces were 2.4 or 4 gigahertz watts. So that's why it was taking so much. Now, what will you gain with that? Well, of course, a high-frequency resolution makes all the difference if you're actually interested in a particular kind of science. So I'm explaining here how the same observation made by the two instruments, HIFI and Teyssier, will give you a completely different picture of what's going on, at least from physico-chemical perspective. So the red spectrum would be what the Orion Kale Teyssier data would look like. So basically, you can detect a couple of features, but all of them, you realize when you go at the very high resolution of spectrum, is just a blend of forest of lines, and you basically, with Teyssier, you've lost the big picture of how every single component of the spectrum is being radiated by a particular species. So that's fundamental if you are basically interested in disentangling the spectral species within a very narrow frequency range. And on top of that, if you're also interested in disentangling the velocity profile, so in other words, the dynamics of the lines, you can only use HIFI, basically. Otherwise, you cannot resolve your spectral lines with the other two spectrometers. So this is very relevant for science, which has to do with the dynamics of the observed regions. Concerning the calibration, there's the other peculiarity of HIFI is that because it is what we call a radiometer, it has to be calibrated on a scale which is a bit non-intuitive at first, which is what we call a temperature scale. And that's a temperature scale which relates basically to black bodies, which are our reference and which were also flown with HIFI in the instruments. So we're permanently comparing the flux from astronomical sources to the one of reference black bodies. But if you detect a line of 1 Kelvin, typically, it doesn't mean that your body has a 1 Kelvin temperature. It's a completely different interpretation. It's what we call a Rayleigh-Jeans temperature. So it's equivalent to the temperature of a black body that would emit that emission. Of course, those ranges can be converted into more intuitive and more physical, meaningful ranges like flux densities of Jenskis, which is the intensity you have on the PAX or the Teyssier spectrometer. But you need to do some assumption on that. So this is something we will come back on in the other talks on how to basically interpret those scales and convert them into scales that may mean something more for your modeling or interpretation. But that's something you have to bear in mind. The temperature the data from HIFI are coming in is a temperature which is only valid for the HIFI instruments. It's specific to the way it was observed there on Herschel in its position in space. It has, if you want to make it a physical, meaningful scale, you have to transform it into a certain scale. And that we will explain how to do that. It's not complicated, it's just you have to make an assumption about how your source is distributed. On the frequency scale, basically we are calibrating everything in the local standard of rest because what's very important, as I say, is if you want to study the dynamic, you want to know exactly how your source velocity is distributed, and we do that with respect to basically the velocity on Earth, the velocity of a line that would be measured in the laboratory on Earth. Now for a solar system object, typically moving targets, it's a bit different, because the velocity depends on the date. It's not like a fixed target. The velocity is always the same. It's the velocity of the expansion of the universe, if you like, or the velocity on the arms of the galaxy, if you are in the Milky Way. For solar system objects, it's slightly different. There's a date difference, a date dependence. And so we put our velocity in the local frame on the target. So in other words, you are at the velocity as if you would be sitting on the planet or on the comet or on the asteroid. So it's like slight difference here. And as I said previously, and that is something you will hear about in the next presentation, the products cannot be, we cannot discriminate between the upper sideband and the lower sideband. They are intrinsically merged. So in that sense, we need to calibrate the frequency scale both in the upper sideband and the lower sideband, because we cannot make the decision at the processing level as to whether a frequency channel belongs to one or the other. So this is something the astronomer will have to decide and make up their mind on. But there are, again, there are tools to help in that process, and we will explain in the next presentations. The accuracy you can expect is actually very high, and that's really inherent to the fact that the Herschel was in space, and that was a very stable instrument, a very stable observatory in that sense. So the frequency accuracy for HIFI is typically the ranges you could use if you need to quote accuracies in papers. It's the order of 2 to 4% in the first five bands, and slightly worse in band 6 and 7, because, as I said, the calibration was a bit more challenging. All these are random errors, so they are due to intrinsic to the instrument calibration. On top of that, we are calibrating our data in an absolute flux scale on a reference, which for HIFI is the Mars planet. So we're using an absolute model of the Mars emission, atmospheric emission, and we calibrate our internal scale onto that one. And because the Mars model has a typical 5% error, which is systematic here, you have to take that into account. So it's a mixture of random, which are due to instrument specifics, and systematic error, which is more due to the model we use to scale our data. If you are not doing relative studies, so imagine you have the same line, you have different lines on the same spectrum instantaneously, then it's different. You have what we call an in-band accuracy, and that's very, very good. It's a couple of percent. If you're not doing some kind of time-dependent study, so in other words, you're observing something and then 5 months later you pick up an observation ID and it was reobserved, then you're limited by the repeatability accuracy, which is in the range 3 to 10%, basically. So all this is very well explained in the HIFI handbook, to which I will give a reference at the end of this presentation, but this is to give you a flavor of the typical accuracy we're talking about. The plot on the bottom actually tells you it's a bit more complicated than that, although it's not really complicated. It's just that because we have such fine granularity in our tuning, in the frequency we can measure, and the instrument behaves slightly different at every different frequency, we actually have a very precise assessment of what the frequency, what the flux accuracy is depending on the frequency. So for band 6 and 7, it's pretty flat. There's no discriminant, but for the other bands, we have actually an accuracy that can depend on the frequency within the boundaries I've just explained above. So this is a summary of the absolute and repeatability accuracy we could expect. So now, what does this mean in terms of science readiness of the data? You will hear in the following presentation what are the remaining possible caveats you find in the data. But here I can already upfront give you some heads up that overall, the calibration is doing a very good job, and we estimate that it's about 1/5 of the data that might still be affected by what we call baseline residual distortion. In other words, your spectrum is not strictly flat. And that is relevant if you want to measure the line intensity, because line intensity is relative to the continuum level or the baseline level. So if your baseline is not flat, you need some more work in order to figure out what's the contrast between the line peak and the line basis, which is basically the baseline level. So we'll give some tricks in the next presentation on how to take care of that. But also, we will explain later in the morning that we will do that work for you for a vast, vast, vast fraction of the data. This is this expert-provided product. On the frequency range, there's nothing you should worry about. The frequency accuracy is extremely high because we are basically bootstrapping our references to a very high precision clock, which is a quartz, basically. It's like an atomic, it's not an atomic clock here, it's a quartz clock, but that means your accuracy is far better than the size of the resolution, basically. It's about a tenth of the resolution. I say that the beam is very important, and that's because HIFI is a single pixel instrument on the sky. So all the information you get is what you get into that pencil beam, and that's very depending on how much you couple onto the sky and onto the size of brightness distribution. So overall, you can assume the HIFI beam is a 2D Gaussian. It has, of course, some side lobes, and we are providing all the details. If you need to do a detailed modeling of typically extended or semi-extended emission, then it might be relevant in your modeling that you plug in into your data the detailed beam profile. That's something we provide. And I said a word in the first presentation this morning. I will explain where you can find this particular information because we are providing that. There's something to bear in mind. We have two polarization, always given simultaneously. It's a redundant information, and later in the morning we explain actually how to combine this information because the polarization are usually not correlated, and so you can gain in signal to noise if you combine them. But you should be aware that they're not the two pencil beams of the respective polarization are not strictly aligned on the sky, and there's a slight offset between the two. This offset is usually very small compared to the half power bandwidth applying at the particular frequencies. But this is something to keep in mind because sometimes you get an archive observation and you look at the H and V polarization data separately, and you might find that the intensity they report is not strictly the same. And that's not completely surprising because, as you can see in this sketch on the right, because the beams are not strictly looking at the position on the sky, if you have gradients in your source brightness distribution, that means you might detect real differences, even if they occur on a spectral scale much lower than the beam. You are sensitive to such gradients, and this can end up with slight differences between H and V intensity. So we call that intensity imbalance. Final slide to just remind you where you can find much more information about that. The absolute Bible, I would say, is the HIFI handbook, which you will find in the legacy documentation page, which is the HIFI component of the explanatory legacy library that you heard about on the first day. And then we have all kind of cookbooks which are more specific to the different observing modes that were used. And of course, if you need and want to use our homebrewed software, HIPE, then you are very welcome to check what the tasks are capable of doing in the data reduction guide. You will hear in the next presentation what those tasks are and what they can do for you. For more top-level or general preferences about radio astronomy and heterodyne detection, I'm just listing you here another series of papers that could be of interest for introduction. So I'm here ready to take your questions if there are any.